July and August, just because we figure a lot of people are away. And then we have September through December scheduled. And we have a researcher from Rutgers talking about genetically modified organisms. We'll have a genetic counselor from a company called Recombine. And then we're going to have somebody talk about the science of food and wine. He's a sommelier and something, I don't know how to say that. So anyway, you can grab one of these. And then on, really probably the most important thing is on the bottom is a website. It's not quite live yet, but we're going to, once it goes live, we'll be able to get all the information if Charlie keeps it up to date, which I'm sure
he will. It's on mobile, but it's not on for
some it'll reason. Be shortly, it'll be live.
Yeah, right? Tomorrow.
So, tomorrow. Okay. All right, well, thank you so much for coming to talk about the birth of a drug. And each one of these slides could probably be its own lecture, but feel free to jump in and ask more questions if I don't go into as much detail as you want. But I was thinking about this, right? So just like the birth of a baby, right? We find out, whoa, that pregnancy test, right? And then we got 9 months before all heck breaks loose and we have to take care of this one. So that takes 9 months, but in the drug discovery process, that we call it, it takes 10 to 15 years for this to happen. And it'll start with an idea. And then that idea might just be somebody in the laboratory thinking that, I think this molecule, this chemical here, might be able to kill cancer, okay? And then we take that idea, move it through the process so it becomes a drug that we can all get at the pharmacy or at the hospital. So, we will walk through that. I mentioned it takes about 10 to 15 years. We are shortening this amount of time because of the Human Genome Project. So the more we understand about your genes, the quicker we can make this happen. And one of the things I want to point out is that if I create this phone and I want to bring it to market, I don't have to wait 10 years to do it, right? And if I did, then the technology would be completely obsolete. So the pharmaceutical industry is kind of unique in that it requires extensive testing before the end product can get to you, the consumer or the patient. Okay, so what are the steps? We're going to go through three steps. I'll describe each of them in more detail, but one is in vitro, then animal testing, and then clinical trials. So what are each one of those? In vitro, like in vitro fertilization in a petri dish, right? You're going to do it in test tubes and flasks. In glass is what it really means. And then once we think that things still look promising, we move into animal test. We'll describe that in more detail. But of course, we're in animal too. But this testing really just refers to non-human animals. And sometimes you'll hear it called preclinical testing. Because a lot of people don't like the idea that we have to use animals, so it just is almost a euphemism to make sure that you're not telling people what you do. Working preclinical testing sounds better than animal research. And then lastly, your clinical trial, and that's when humans come into play. Gosh. Okay, so let's look. A few more terms. I already mentioned in vitro, in glass, in a test tube, and the other two are in silico and in vivo. So, in vitro would be things like a petri dish and a test tube. In silico is in a computer. And something else that's helping to shorten the times of drug discovery are the fact that we can use computer models to see whether something's going to work or not. So, for instance, if this is a molecule that is causing your cells to grow out of control and cause cancer, and I think this is the one that's going to stop that molecule, the computer can tell me whether these two are going to fit together. And this will really inactivate this. So in silico testing, I don't really talk about it in this lecture, but it's a really important part of what we call drug discovery. And then eventually, of course, we have to move into the body. And I'll tell you a little bit about why what we find out here doesn't always translate to what we find out in the body. Okay, so here's the idea, right? The first scientist who comes up with this idea, again, that maybe this chemical here is going to be the one to cure cancer. And then she says, okay, I'm going to put that in a test tube. And if we could zoom into the test tube, maybe we have all these different cells here, right? And then these are, this is, the little blue dots are this chemical, and we can see that the cancer cells are exploding. And that's great, this is really promising. And you might hear about this on the news, but we have to take this with a little grain of salt because it's so early on in the process. I found this cartoon, sorry, no reference here, but it says, when you see a claim that a common drug kills cancer cells in a petri dish, keep in mind, so does a handgun. Okay, so this may work in the petri dish, but when it gets into me, it kills all my good cells as well, right? The other difficulty, and the reason that we need to move past in vitro testing and into these other animals is because of this. That, first of all, the cancer, when I put this drug on top of the petri dish, the cells were right here. There was no impedance between the drug and the cells. But if you have cancer, the cancer's deep in this body somewhere. How do I get this drug into the body to where it needs to work? Now, I might be able to give it to your stomach and just hope to heck that in the pill form this doesn't get completely destroyed, but it's probably going to get destroyed. Or maybe I give it to you by intravenous or something like that to get it to where it needs to be. But this guy right here, a real problem. The liver is a great thing. It takes toxins and breaks them apart and spits them out so that you don't die of other things. The liver doesn't know that this is not a toxin. And so even if it gets in there and gets to the cancer or in your blood system, the liver might kind of remove this. And it's called clearance. So you can have the best drug in the world, but if your liver tries to get rid of it too soon, it's not going to work. It doesn't ever get a chance to get to the cancer. Another part is, this is a real immune cell here. It's called a macrophage, and these happen to be bacteria. But your immune system also knows when things are foreign, and it does a great job of getting rid of those things. And that's good for us, right? Because smallpox is foreign and Zika virus is foreign, so we want to get rid of those. But the immune system might not know, yeah, this is foreign, it's not part of Laura, but I need it for her to fight this cancer. So these are the things that you don't have in the petri dish. I don't have an immune system in the petri dish. I don't have a liver. I just have this drug and the cells, okay? So when you hear again, oh, we have this great new drug, they don't usually tell you that it's still in the petri dish, but if it's in the petri dish, there's a long, long way to go. And statistically, I'll show you a slide at the very end that shows you how infrequently a drug really does succeed from that beginning idea in the petri dish on. Okay, so these are some of the animals that we might use. And Mary just walked in, and I'm trying to talk her into telling us more about preclinical testing because she has extensive experience there. But, you know, you hear about a lot of testing done on mice, and you're going to see that we use lots and lots of mice. This is what kind of saddens us, right, when we have to see that some we call them non-human primates are tested. But even before the chimpanzee, there are other types of, there are monkeys that we use as well. The fruit fly tells us an awful lot about how drugs can be handled. Now, the numbers that I have here show, oh, this is C. elegans. I forgot to mention this little guy. He's a roundworm, and he shares 50% of his DNA with me. And then you can see the male's 75, the chimpanzee's 98. So when somebody's doing tests on a worm, you're like, what in the heck am I wasting my tax money on worm research? It's because there's a lot of things I can learn from him to translate into me. Not everything, of course, because there's a whole bunch that's different. But you know how there's people for the ethical treatment of animals? Like, I've never seen a sign that says, stop testing on the roundworm, right? So people want that. Okay. Now, I thought I'd give you an idea of some of the animals that we do test on. And again, if you have questions, jump in, and Mary could probably answer many more. But I like this slide for a couple of reasons, but it leaves a huge part out. This up here stands for the American Welfare Act. And as you can see, these are the animals that are covered under that American Welfare Act. So you can see guinea pigs are a good 20%. We use hamsters and rabbits are another 30%. You can see those non-human primates, which would be monkeys and chimpanzees. okay, cats and dogs. But here's the thing. This number, if we take a look at the numbers, all of those, because the USDA handles those animals, all of those are about 1 million animals a year. That number, some of these numbers are a little misleading, because if a dog is in a study, and he's in the study for multiple years, they count him every year. So these are annual numbers, but it doesn't mean there's 57,000 new dogs every year, okay? But the most important thing I want to point out is that what do you see missing in this slide? There's no mice there, right? There's no rats there, and Mary, why would that be? Because the USDA doesn't regulate them. And so this says USDA statistic, and here is the American Welfare Act, and they're not part of that regulation. So let's take this and put it into a bigger pie with mice and rats included, and there is that little sliver. Okay, so you can see the mice and rats in blue here are about 95%. You'll see different numbers. I've seen as low as 80%. But the lion's share of the animals are the mice and the rats.
And unfortunately, people don't always care about them, do they?
Okay. Now, I just thought I'd also mention about the American Welfare Act, because that's what I was in a couple slides ago. This act was, I guess, instituted in the 60s and 66. And unlike the recycle thing, which I forget there's three because now I only know these, there are three things: reduce, replace, and refine. And as much as we as medical scientists know, we believe that we have to use animals in research. But what we want to do is make sure that we don't overuse them, we don't mistreat them in the time that they're participating in the study willingly. So, of course, we want to reduce the number of animals. We could probably give a whole lecture on ways that we can do that. We want to replace them if we can. So if I can do something in a petri dish instead of in an animal, I'll do that, okay? And then refine, and the refine has a lot of parts to it, but we might refine the study, or we might refine the living conditions of the animal, right? And so, for instance, if animals like to live together with other animals, and you can let them live together, then you don't separate them. You don't put mice in individual cages unless it's a part of the study. And there is a lot. As a matter of fact, I pulled this slide from one that we had gotten from Dr. Hoberman a very long time ago. And I didn't know if I could put him in here, so he's actually over here. I didn't put him in the slide. But they went to visit Japan, I believe it is, and you can see all the animals that are here. And there is this is a memorial, and it says, in commemoration of laboratory animals sacrificed for the contribution towards the progress of life sciences. And if I could just say one thing, is that people like Dr. Koberman who work in this field, they don't hate animals. They really love them, and they will argue for the ethical treatment of animals every day. Okay, now here's another one. PETA never complains about a zebrafish, right? So we are using more and more fish for preclinical testing as well. You guys have to ask questions because I can't. Oh yes, thank you. I got to breathe.
Have they ever used the same animal for duplicate stuff?
I don't think they're supposed to.
They're not allowed to. Technically not allowed to, because you don't know if any of the treatment that you, some, they'll be, animals that are different treatment groups that get treatments, but even the ones that are in the control group aren't allowed to be used again either.
Yes,
because you don't know if they've got something airborne or anything like that. So at the end of this study, they're all gone.
Yes, yes.
Yes,
yes.
Are they take donations? Yes. I have a cat.
Yeah, that's a really good question. Yes.
You said that mice aren't tracked. Is that the word they kind of grandfathered in from? Just the history of
one thing that I've heard is that there's too many. I didn't tell you the totals. The totals, there are 25 million animals are used a year.
A million of something other than a mice or a rat.
Yes. So it's just so many. I'm not really sure. Do you know why?
I don't know that I've ever heard of why they weren't ever trapped. I think it probably was the sheer number of them on the
Yes.
Well, they're not really that cute, so that's why
they don't. Well, some of them are cute.
They are adorable.
The first time you see them, they're they're not cute, then, you know, when you watch them
they grow
from being a little baby,
yes,
then they're cute.
Nobody likes a rat.
Oh, I wanted to
share. No, there's the,
you know, while we're here, you know, I just
a lot of different kinds.
This was an interesting one. So we use, you saw 800,000 other animals, but the whole number, including mice and rats, is 25 million. That's in our country, like UK is, I think, 3 million, something like that. But I saw this slide that I thought was interesting. So here's research. That tiny sliver of the 0.3% of all the animals that we kill, 9 billion is for food. We kill 365 million in car accidents. We hit them, right? We hunt 200 million. And so, you know, fourth on the list is research. So really the amount of animals used in research is a tiny sliver relative to the overall. Okay. So let me... Oh, the zebra fish. So again, what can we find out about these fish? These fish breed quickly, they're see-through, so you can really get a feel for how a drug might be affecting them. And then this slide, you know, I don't really like to use slides that are graphical, too graphical, but I just want you to want you to see that human chromosomes are listed across here, right? We have 22, and then we have an X and a Y. And then these are the zebra fish, and they have 25 chromosomes. It's kind of funny, because if you think you're all that important, because you have, you know, 23 chromosomes or pet pairs, they have more than we do. But each red dot represents a gene that is in zebrafish that's also in humans. So again, and this is just a, you know, a representation of many, many other genes, but you can see that there's a lot of similarities, just like there are with that little roundworm that I showed you a couple slides back. Okay, so we've done the in vitro testing. We moved on to the animals, and we've gotten a lot of information. A lot of drugs already fell out of the pipeline here, and now things are looking promising. We're now going to go into other other animals, of course us, but we just call those clinical trials, right? So this is where we come in. And it's also kind of where the FDA comes in. Now the FDA really is involved all along, but before we go into humans, the FDA wants to know everything that's happened before now. Every ill event, every mouse that died, every roundworm that proliferated, whatever. They need to know all those because they want to make sure that this is as safe as we can be before we go into humans. So that's where the FDA comes in. We're going to submit something called an investigational new drug application. It's called an IND. And as I told you, we give them all the information from the previous years. One thing that I want to just go back and show you is the timeline about this point, right, is maybe we spent about 6 years here. So this is about 2, the preclinical testing is about 4, you know, each drug's going to be a little bit. Now, I thought, let me talk to you a little bit about the FDA and the history of the FDA and what they do for us. The FDA is a U.S. government organization, the Food and Drug Administration. And I want to point out that we have no control over what happens in the rest of the world. So the European Union has their own European Medical Evaluation Association or agency. In Japan, they have the Pharmaceutical Food Safety Bureau, and they can make their own decisions. So sometimes you'll hear about something that's approved in another country that's not approved here. We just have a different set of regulations. We really are trying to have some consistency across all these because all of the big pharmaceutical companies are global. So they want to make sure that if they get approval in the United States, that they can certainly bring this over to Europe. So they do their best to satisfy everybody's rules. Okay, so a little bit about the history. Going back to the 1800s, the late 1800s, we had no control over, or the government had no control over what you took, right? So I pulled up a few of these, what they call patent medicine. So Hardy's Magic Pain Destroyer, cocaine toothache drops, right? And look, little kids, oh, that's great, get a little bit of pain, right? And this is my favorite one, because my grandmother used to always use this one. Carter's liver pills. She'd say, you have more problems if Carter has liver pills. I was like, what are you talking about? Now I know. he's a University of Pennsylvania vaccine researcher. And anyway, he talks a little bit about, here's a drug called Nature's True Remedy that cures rheumatism, cancer, diabetes, baldness, bad breath, and curvature of the spine. And they could just say it, right? They could just say it. Here's Pond's extract treats meningitis. This one drug treats asthma, bronchitis, cancer, dysentery, eczema. It goes on and on, okay? I love this. Here's another one. Dr. Williams' pink pills for pale people. I don't even know what that is. But even back in the late 1800s, this was a $75 million a year business. This was huge, right? Now, Samuel Hopkins and this Harvey Wiley are really responsible for the FDA, because Harvey Wiley had his own experience with food regulation and what they were doing with the, you know, when they slaughtered the meats and all that sort of thing, right? But Samuel Hopkins wrote something called The Great American Fraud, and it was about saying that these patent medicines cured all these diseases, okay? And I'm gonna come back to this in a minute, so I'll forget. So what he found out was that many of these patent medicines contained alcohol. And let me just give you an example. One had 21%, one 28%. And he said, to put this in perspective, beer has 4 to 6%. Wine has 10%, and whiskey has 35%. There was more alcohol in these treatments than there was, and we were giving them to kids. Red Samuel, some of them had opium, morphine, hashish, and cocaine. One of them, Winslow's Soothing Syrup, was loaded with morphine. And Samuel Hopkins Adams had a night maid, I don't know what the heck that even is, but she would leave her kids at home at night, come take care of him in his house. And he said, well, how do you leave your small children at home? And she said, they're okay, just one teaspoon of Winslow's and they lay like dead until morning. It's crazy, it's really crazy. But the two of them realized that we need somebody to oversee. So you could say anything back then. You could put anything on the label back then. It didn't matter. Okay. Now, so 1906, under Teddy Roosevelt's purview, we have the Food and Drug Act. And at the time, I just want to point out that all we controlled was labeling. So if in this bottle there is, you know, Korean ginseng, it better be Korean ginseng or the FDA is after you. But what they say about what it does, we weren't controlling that. And was it safe? They weren't controlling that either. We're just going to tell you what's on the bottle is really what's in here. Okay, and that's in 1906. Of course, several things happened which lead to FDA reform. And in, for instance, there was this tragedy, a sulfanilamide tragedy. This was kind of like a penicillin, a little bit different, produced by a company named Acipil. And a lot of people were using it, a lot of adults were using it in pill form. But people wanted to have liquid form, in particular for kids. Many companies did it, but Massengill had the hot thing. They put raspberry in it, right? Remember when we used to have strawberry liquid that we used to take in antibiotics? They put raspberry in there, so everybody was using it. It led to hundreds of deaths, including many, many children. And, or I should say a hundred deaths, but hundreds of illnesses, it led to kidney failure. And what they did when they solubilized it is they put it into diethylene glycol, which you probably know, Tom, is antifreeze. It's like, well, we have antifreeze. Sadly, what happened, they knew when they were doing the testing before these deaths that 3% of diethylene glycol caused fatal kidney failure in rats. And they put 72% in this. Now, the scientist who did this felt terrible about it. The CEO said, hey, it wasn't my problem. Nobody told me I couldn't put all this in there. But the scientist went about committing suicide over this. Sad, sad story. But this is what led to us saying, we have got to control. Somebody's got to make sure that something's safe before. Okay, so now we've revised the Food and Drug Act and cosmetics. Now it includes drug safety, it includes labeling, but efficacy. Does it do what I tell you it does? Nobody's telling me that I can't say that. This cures cancer. Okay, good. It doesn't, but you know, the FDA is not going to throw me in jail for that. That had to be changed too, okay? So this is a story, some of you may have lived through this back in the 60s. This was a drug called thalidomide. And these children are children of thalidomide, like Billy Joel says. They have no real limbs. They have hands, and some of them had feet that protruded directly from their torso. It was a condition called phocomelia. This drug was never approved in the United States. You can see up here in the Washington Post, it says heroin of the FDA keeps bad drug off the market. And that's Francis Kelsey. Francis Kelsey just got a new job at the FDA. And they gave her this no-brainer, like just give her an easy case. This drug was used in Germany for years. And they said, well, this company wants to bring it over to the US and market it here. They just figured she'd give it the stamp of approval and be done. But she kept asking questions. Why do I see this? Why do I see this? Your rat studies don't show what happened in people and on and on. I mean, we could probably do a whole lecture on this one study. Very, very interesting. It was never approved in the United States. Unfortunately, about 25,000 children were born with phocomelia. Some in this country, yes.
What was thalidomide originally given for?
Oh, this is really interesting. It was a sleep aid. Oh, and I really love that big part of it. But it was a sleep aid in animals, but didn't necessarily have that effect in human animals. So how could you move from one animal to the other and not have to explain to the FDA? But it was given to pregnant women for nausea. Okay, now you know, like at least when I had my kids, which was a while ago, like Tums and Tylenol. That's like all you could take, right? Because Francis Kelsey knew that fetuses don't metabolize. Their livers don't do the things that adult livers do. So for instance, when you can have a glass of wine and you're fine. If you're pregnant, your baby, they say, has that wine five times because something, an enzyme called alcohol dehydrogenase, which breaks alcohol, they don't have yet. They don't even make it because why would a fetus need something to break down alcohol? She knew that from other studies, and she was keenly familiar with the sulfanilamide tragedy. But yet, it was marketed for anti-nausea, but had sleeping effect, anti-nausea as a sleep aid as well, which makes you wonder what's the mechanism here. Okay. This led to the next reform, which really almost gets us to where we are today. So back in the 60s, now we say, even though the thalidomide had nothing to do with saying whether a drug worked or not, it was more to do with safety, but we've added efficacy, which just means, does it cure cancer if I tell you it cures cancer, okay? You have to get consent from patients. Advertising was key here. Pardon me. One of the scientists at Bonn University in Germany happened to notice in Europe that there was an increase in children with this phocomelia. And he looked at the marketing material. The company was, the Merrill company is the one who wanted to bring it here. I can't remember the German company's name. And the German company's marketing material back in the late 50s, they said that this was used in the United States and in Canada. Whereas it was never approved in the United States, and I don't know about Canada. So this Bonn University researcher said, well, I guess if I only see this phocomelia in Europe, but it's used everywhere, thalidomide's used everywhere, that must not be what's causing the problem. So that's why the FDA, and when you listen to these commercials and they tell you every negative side effect, the pharmaceutical companies have to tell you those negative side effects. And that's a part of this amendment from the 1960s. We also have to list all the ingredients. So for instance, with sulfanilamide, back in the day, you would just have to say it's sulfanilamide. You wouldn't have to mention the diethylene glycol. So you see active ingredients and then inactive ingredients. That's because of this amendment. Yes?
I can't remember where I've heard this. It might have been from you, but the guy that invented snake oil couldn't get the patent because there was no snake oil in it.
Oh, no, I didn't hear that.
Oh, okay, that's right. Mm-hmm. But it was the same idea. This was well before the COVID virus. So.
Yes, yes. So there's really three things. One is labeling, which was the first thing that the Food and Drug Administration looked over. The second was safety. And then the third is, does it do what I claim it does? Okay. I want to point out, and I'm going to need glasses for this one, that not everything's regulated by the FDA. This Korean ginseng, I'll tell you what it claims it does. Let's see. It claims it promotes physical performance, okay? But a little asterisk afterwards says, these statements have not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This product is intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. Vitamins and pseudo-natural products are not under the purview of the FDA. So don't think that everything that you buy at GNC or everything that comes from a natural source is safe. And I read something, a really good analogy. Let's say there's something in a cantaloupe that is good for you. Well, I can probably only eat one cantaloupe at a time, but a pill can extract that and put eight cantaloupes in one pill. Well, throughout history, cantaloupe never killed anybody because we couldn't eat eight cantaloupes, right? Our stomach would have limited how much of that chemical. And so with these pills, we often get a much higher concentration than you would from a natural product. Now, I want to say the FDA is responsible, but so is the company that makes the drug, so are the doctors that are a part of the clinical trials, everybody's a part of this. And there are drugs that get through all of this and still wind up being a problem in the end. And you guys have heard about Vioxx, and what was it, 2006 or something like that. There's a lot of cases, I guess there are still lawsuits against Merck because of this drug, which was for... It caused heart disease, but it was, now I just forgot what it was for. But, and I'll explain to you why sometimes we don't see the problems until later. Okay, so now that's the FDA, clinical trials. We go through really four clinical trials, but three of them have to be complete before you go to market. So I'm going to quickly go through this. Evidence-based medicine, Dr. Lin, James Lin, is the first one who ever did it. So what's evidence-based? Instead of me just saying, you know what, I eat cantaloupe a lot, I think there's something about cantaloupe that like keeps people healthy, you would run a trial and you would see, people who eat cantaloupe, are they healthier than people who don't? And this, you guys may have heard of Limeys, you know, the sailors would have scurvy, right, because they would be out to sea for so long and they had vitamin deficiencies. And James Lin figured out that it may have been because they didn't have any fresh fruits or vegetables. So what he did was one ship went out with a whole bunch of limes, and one ship went out with no limes, and he found out that indeed that helped with scurvy because the vitamin C is critical for a lot of things in the body. So he was the first one to do that. But the purpose of these clinical trials is we just want to make sure if the drug is safe and effective. Now in the first phase, we only have, you know, tens of people, maybe under 100, somewhere like that, and notice they're healthy. So how do I know whether the drug cures cancer or not? I don't, right? Because it's only healthy people. I'm really, in this phase, only looking at safety. And then I want to see, well, what's the range? Can I give you 10 milligrams and it's safe, 200 milligrams and it's safe, or what level is it not safe anymore? And this takes about a year. So again, when you hear about, something's in clinical trials and they say it's going to cure cancer, if it's in phase one, we don't know at all whether it cures cancer in humans. We've never tried that yet. Then we move on to phase two. All the while, we're dealing with the FDA. And now we have hundreds of people. Now we're starting to look at healthy and sick people. And of course, since it's sick people as well, we can look at whether the drug is effective. That takes a couple of years. Phase three, again, we're looking at a larger group of people. We're looking in the thousands this time. We're looking at safety, side effects of the drug. So everything you hear in those commercials, we found out about those side effects during these trials. And we start to compare it to other treatments. So for instance, if it's a cholesterol medicine, I want to compare it to Lipitor. And is my drug better than Lipitor? So that's what we're doing in phase three. And this takes several years, longer than the phase one and two. If everything goes well, you then go back to the FDA, sort of back, and you say, here is my application. And when we'll come back to this later. Here is my application. This is a picture, I think, from the 60s of a new drug application. in biological terms, we call it a biological license application. It was 300,000 pages on average is what a BLA or an NDA is. We moved it to the computer, thank goodness, but it took a long, long time. 300,000 pages and you had to copy it three times. So they used to like just have these big, you know, whatever, really things. So anyway, that's what you do. And now the FDA, before it approves, it takes a while, right? It takes, so this was the more complicated. Here's our in vitro studies. Here's our animal tests. These are all the human tests. And then look at this here. FDA review and approval takes over a year. And meanwhile, I want to point out, if you're GlaxoSmithKline, you apply for your patent right here. And every day, your patent is ticking away. And you only have 20 years. And by the time you get it to market, you lost half of that time, if not more. Okay? But it takes a long time for the FDA to review this. Yes?
Question. Is it reasonable to think that the FDA would read all that material?
Well, so what they do is they divide it between people. These people look at toxicology, these people look at clearance. And I hope.
Yeah, it just seems like they're a lot of
Right. But here's the thing, they are responsible. If something does get approved and then there's any negligence shown, then they are responsible just like the pharmaceutical company is, as well as the doctor might be.
Plus when you submit that, there are parts of that submission that are summaries. So there's a summary that goes on the front part of it, and then it references where the detail is. So if somebody just glanced over the summary, they would figure out what part of the detail they wanted to go into. So they may not look at every page, but there are certain standards that you have to do to point stuff out.
Yeah, that's
and there's a lot of tables that are summary tables that go on top of everything too. So they can see at a quick glance, you know, where the problems are, you know, all the different things that might have gone wrong or somebody reported as a problem on the drug, and then, you know, depending on what those problems were, it might get farmed out to another person to look at, because the person it originally goes to might not have, you know, a lot of information about a GI tract problem, so they might pull somebody else in if they see the drug has a lot of GI problems on it.
So there's some checks and balances.
Yeah, there is, but I, you know, if you want somebody to say they read every page, I'd be really weary if somebody told you they did.
Right.
Just because of the way the application goes in and all the stuff that goes on top of it.
Adverse effects.
Adverse effects. Very good. There was a time, I don't know if they still do it anymore, but the big pharmaceutical companies joined together, several of them, and paid the FDA to hire more reviewers. Because again, you have a $1 billion drug, or in today's parlance, you got like a $10 billion drug, you're waiting a year and a half, you're waiting even 365,000 days. So what they did was, okay, we hired, there wasn't really a conflict, because I wasn't like buying you, like over here, but I was just paying the government to be able to hire more. Like I said, I'm not sure if they're still doing that, but yeah.
But did you say that your patent starts back there?
Yes. And this is the other difference, again, like with our phone, right? I don't know how long it takes, but you come up with this idea, I don't have to do testing, so my patent started and I went to market not too far apart from each other, right? Yeah, so for the pharmaceutical companies, and the reason they patent way back here is because they don't want somebody else to steal this idea.
Can I ask something along those lines too? This is a little bit as well. I heard that they were patenting like genes. And how does that, have they stopped doing that?
Well, okay, so here's the thing, and that's a really good point. You can't really just patent a gene, if this is the gene, I can't say, well, I own this. Well, because you have the gene, and you have the gene, and I have the gene, so it has to be unique.
A collection.
Yes, and so what you do with the gene, you don't patent the gene itself, you patent a test that can see if you have that gene that tells you whether you might get breast cancer in the future. So you guys have heard of BRCA1 and Angelina Jolie.
Yeah.
That gene, well, that's actually still, it's going now to the Supreme Court because they're arguing that they should retake the patent away. But Myriad has a patent for the test of that gene. Or maybe I patent expressing that gene, taking the gene, making the protein, and giving it to you as a medicine. I can't just say the A's, the T's, C's, and G's. I just can't patent that. Okay, so
it has to be a unique combination.
Yes, there has to be a use for it, use for it, and but that was a really big thing. And when we were sequencing genes, Craig Venter, who you may have heard of, he just submitted a whole bunch of them to the patent office, and they were just these little snippets of genes. And the patent office said, "Well, what do they do? And you know, what are you going to do with them?" And he didn't have that, so those were rejected. So again, if you just take the letters and say you're going to patent it, that the patent office will reject that. There has to be a particular use for it.
Okay.
That's a really good question. So yeah, so the patent starts here, the patent lasts for 20 years,
right.
And a lot of those years go away. And so kind of my message here is to see how much money and how much time goes into this, so that when pharmaceutical companies charge us a lot, and I'm not saying that nobody does anything wrong, but when they charge us a lot of money went into this process, okay?
So two other things are happening in that timeline too that aren't really science related but are more business related here. So what you have is when you're in your phase three trials, you have your commercial people from your company starting to come in to say, okay, when's this going to hit the market? When can I start doing this? And they start making projections outward of the revenue stream that this drug is going to create. So there's a lot of pressure in the phase three to get the thing in there, done, and get it ready, because you've already got the marketing people looking at it to say, where's it going to come on to market? How am I going to market it? They're doing all those things. And then the other thing that you're racing against there is, there are usually other indications on the market that are similar to yours, and you want to be first to the market. So that's the other thing that starts happening in the phase three. You're watching all your competitors, and you're saying, you know, they looks like they're going to get here in March. Is there any way we can get here in January? Because, you know, if you're the first one to market, that usually means that you're going to get more of the sales than anybody else is.
Right.
So, you know, it becomes a non-science game at some point in time, you know, which makes it really tough, because the science people are starting to say, I need to do good science, and the marketing people are saying, we need to make some money.
Yes.
So, you know, we have that
it's
trade-off
true,
there.
And you're right. Like, I worked at Galaxus with clients. We'd be working on something, and everything was looking good, and then they'd say, we're dropping that project, because they knew that Merck was ahead of us. And like Mary said, if you're already taking drug X and it seems to be working for you, why are you going to try drug Y? You're not, you know? So when they know that, so that's a really good point. And that being said, don't you think Mary should be one of our speakers in the future? I got to go for it. Hey there. That's great. That's a great point, that it does start to morph into something that's not just science. Yes?
It just seems to me, when you're in the early stages, you may think, oh, we need to tweak it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So then do you start the process all over again? And so,
yeah, that's a really interesting point, because if you tweak it too much, the FDA, not only do they look at the drug, they look at the process. And there's a company, I don't know if they're still doing it, but it was Lilly, that they were working with cells that are attached. And for those who do cell culture, we hate attached cells, right? And so they had to stick to plastic. So they had these big roller bottles. And instead of being in a state-of-the-art reactor, they just had roller bottles after roller bottles after roller bottles. They knew the technology was better. They knew they could go and do something quicker, but they'd have to go back to the FDA and say, is what's in the roller bottle identical to what I'm going to make in this new state-of-the-art technology? And sometimes it's not worth it for them to do it. So yeah, there is tweaking. Typically we call this part discovery, and then this part is development. And so they are developing the process a bit, and sometimes they look for optimization of the chemicals. It depends on what type of chemical you're talking about. Yes?
What happens during clinical trials if you're testing two drugs and have three different groups of people? You're testing two drugs and then healthy people.
Mm-hmm.
And as you're testing, you find out that one of the drugs is causing more harm than good. Can you just drop it?
Can you just drop it?
Or do you have to keep giving it?
I think that would be more unethical. Yeah, they would be able to
you
just
have to
stop
just
them.
Drop it and
yes.
Let the FDA know immediately.
Right,
so,
right.
We're not using this anymore because it was causing more harm. We're just going to use the other drug and healthy
people. And the healthy people, yes, absolutely.
Works.
You're allowed to do that.
Yes, yes.
You don't have to keep killing people just because you're in the process of. And you guys, there was this Tuskegee experiment back in, when, but they were doing tests for syphilis. They had treatment for these people, they never told them. They wanted to see the long-term effects of having syphilis, and they let these people live without treatment. So that is the, I'm trying to think of
why you had to do informed consent.
Informed consent, yes, and there were some rule for that.
You had to know if you were giving somebody something.
Yes,
they had to agree to take it.
And that's why in this whole process, I talk about the IND, then the NDA, but you're talking the FDA through the whole point.
I was going to point that out. You're bringing them along every step, so if there's any change that you're going to make from what you originally told them you were going to do, you have to bring them in and you have to say, this is what we told you we're going to do, and now something's happening. Right. We realize we can't do it this way, which happens a lot in pediatric trials because you have an idea of how it's going to work in pediatrics, and then you get people that come into the trial, and it doesn't quite happen that way because they're children, and a lot of things go wrong or go differently than you planned. So you have to bring them in, and they have to agree again that you. But that in that timeline there, that's not really shown in that timeline because you might have to stop your trial or slow down the pace at which you're enrolling because you want to make a change and the FDA hasn't said okay to it. And the FDA has rules where it says, if you give us a letter, we'll get back to you in 90 days, you can't just say immediately raise your hand and say, I need you today.
Yes.
Let's put the letter in and in 90 days we'll give you something. And then they give you a response. And then if you want a counter response, you get into this, okay, you can counter response for 30 days. And then we get another 90 days to look at your counter response. You could be going for 2 years and just trying to get a response to one question.
Yes.
And if it's really messing up the way that your trial's running, it does really lengthen the amount.
This whole time.
Timeline.
It takes, yes.
And
you had a question or something? I'm just looking at the healthy volunteers. How do you get people to take these drugs?
They get a small stipend. A lot of your phase ones, they're done in these clinics, where they're to me they feel like they look like little mini spas, It's like a 3-day vacation or a 5-day vacation.
Yes.
Where, you go in, they feed you, house you and all those other things.
Get away from your kids.
It depends on what the drug is, how fast you can get your phase ones enrolled in your healthy volunteers. But when you're in your phase three, you still have you still have a group that's not getting the drug.
Yes.
So if you really have that indication, you don't really want to be in that group where you're going to be in the control group.
Yeah.
And you also don't want to be somebody who gets the drug and finds out it's helping you, and then at the end of the trial, you're stuck because it's going to be a couple years until you're going to be able to get it online. So what they do is they entice you with, they have what's called an open label study at the end of the first study, which is the double blind. They have an open label, which guarantees everybody will get the drug. So some people, if they're sick enough, and depending on what the indication is, they'll just hang on to the end of the double blind one to say, I know I'm going to get the drug in another year. So if I'm not lucky enough to get it in the beginning, I'll at least be able to pick it up in a year. And your open labels are usually 2 years. They're really meant to be the gap period between when the study ends and the drug actually comes on the market. So you have a lot of enticement that way. Because to me, when I first looked at it, I'm like, well, why would I want to go on it if I have a 50-50 chance?
Exactly.
If I need a drug, I don't want to be in a double-blind study. Right. But that's really how they get people to participate in a lot of times.
I remember I worked at Medical College of Pennsylvania, so there's all the med students who are there. And right outside the cafeteria, they were just, want to be part of this clinical trial, want to be a part of this. And again, you're going to get money for this, right?
So I skipped over this, and this is an important one. So if I need to know whether a drug is effective or not, I have to have some people who have a disease that get the drug, see if it works, and then I have to compare it to people who don't get the drug, right? And so in particular, there are some diseases or conditions that are quantitative. So I can see that you had a cholesterol level of 600, and I can see it drop. But other diseases are not so quantitative, where there's too many variables involved, right? But depression's one that I always talk about. How do I know whether
whether this depression drug helped people out, unless some people didn't get it. Because sometimes just by taking something, I mean, if I take St. John's Wort and it says it promotes happiness, I might just feel happier because I think, you know? And that's what we call the placebo effect, right? So when you go into these trials, it's randomized. And like Mary said, you don't know whether you're getting the placebo or the actual drug. And it has to be done that way. And it does stink if you're the person who's sick, but we're never going to know whether it really works or not. And then
neither does your physician either, just so you
what's
know.
That?
Neither does your physician doesn't know that.
Yes,
either.
So that's
and it's double-blind.
Double-blind.
Even the people that are giving the trial, like we as the company,
right.
We don't know who those people are.
You don't
we can kind of sometimes figure it out based on results we're getting, and so probably could your physician, but technically,
yes.
You don't, nobody is.
Nobody should know.
At the end of the trial, they unblind it, and at that point in time, it becomes apparent.
Yes, so then you can see here's the doctor giving a drug, right?
Yeah,
so the patient, neither one knows, right? And that's what double blinded is. And so anyway, and the reason all of this has to do with one big word in science is control. I need to have control so that I know if this drug, or I lost my drug, right? Does this drug really do what I think it's going to do? Or I'm telling you it's going to do. And then, like Mary said, so it's double-blind and neither side knows. And I was just going to say something else about, because there's something called confirmational bias that's similar to the placebo effect. Scientists often see what they set out to see. You know, you want to. You're not being malicious, but you, like, I think those numbers look pretty good. But when you can't tell that this is the control versus the treatment group, then you can't see that. Okay, so now hopefully, oh my goodness, we finally get to work. But we don't stop there, right? We keep on evaluating, right? This is why we found out that Vioxx was not good and we pulled this from the market. So we do what's called post-marketing or phase four studies. And in phase four, we look at long-term effects. Because if we think about how long any given person was on this drug, it's really like a couple of years. So what if after 7 years, this does so much liver damage that it's not good for people anymore? So that's what we do, is we look at long-term effects, we look at different populations. Does this drug treat women differently than it does men? Does it treat African-Americans or African descent versus Asian differently? So we look at that, and then here's the big key. Are there other indications? Right? So I just put a lot of money and a lot of time into this, and I'm going to tell you it's going to cure high cholesterol. But what if it can like thin your blood at the same time or do something else? Then I already know it's safe. I just have to kind of prove that other indication. And this process is called repurposing. And in repurposing, this just shows a few drugs to give you an idea. So here's the drug here, like metformin. The initial indication was type 2 diabetes. But also they're seeing that there's breast cancer, or anti-breast cancer here. Tamoxifen started out as breast cancer. They see bipolar disorder. So here's the thing. We have to understand things at the molecular level. All right, so molecules are way smaller than cells, right? There are billions of molecules in each cell. But if I understand that this is interacting with this chemical, then I can make better predictions, because this chemical that was in, you know, that had something to do with diabetes also has something to do with cancer. And I can make better predictions as to what other indications might there be. The other thing I might be able to do is to minimize side effects. Because if this drug also interferes with something that's really good for me, then I'm going to know that ahead of time. Targeted drug delivery is really key. But anyway, repurposing is great. Because the cost of a new drug, you can see a lot of different numbers, but this came out of Forbes. It's now about $5 billion to get one drug to market. And here's where that number doesn't really even tell you the truth. This is the whole process again. There's the, sorry, I got 1 minute. I get nervous when I'm running out of time here. So this was like from the idea through animal tests all the way down to when it got approved. The idea stage starts out with about 10,000, we'll say 10,000. And for every 10,000 of these that I start thinking is a great idea, one of them gets to market. Statistically, it's dismal. So if it took this guy $5 billion to get to market, what about all of these that fell out because they weren't, they didn't do what I thought they were going to do in the test tube, they were too toxic in the animals, a human body is different than a mouse body, and they all fall out. Well, you're paying for all the tests that get there. So when they say that you're paying the drug, you're not only paying for this drug, you're paying for the research that went into this drug and the research that went into other drugs or the future research that'll go into the next 10,000 compounds. Okay? And so with that, I leave you with hug pharmaceutical scientists. Mary will give you hugs on the way out. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you guys all for coming and thank you for your questions.
Very good.
Thank you.
Phase 1, phase 3, and you do those all those for